Hello, my name is Mr. Sparks, and I will be your instructor for Biology 102 this semester at John Tyler Community College. We will be using the textbook Campbell Biology in Focus. We're going to begin the semester by studying the process of evolution, and we'll begin on Chapter 19, Descent with Modification. These are the overviews. They occur in the beginning of every chapter, and they include interesting facts that are pertinent to the chapter. It's not always easy to see how these are connected, but by the end of the chapter, we should have a greater understanding. Lepidoptera and insects, moths and butterflies, have many features in common, including a juvenile feeding stage called the caterpillar. Probably everyone's familiar with caterpillars. In fact, if you're in the spring semester, we're going to see the cankerworm or a silkworm that parachutes out of the trees on a silk line all over town. They're usually very numerous. Those are an example of caterpillars, also sometimes called inchworms. There are also many other caterpillars that occur in people's gardens, and they can be a pest. Lepidopteran species also have many features that are distinct from each other in both caterpillar and adult forms. So they're all related, but they all have a great diversity. Lepidopterans illustrate three key observations about life. The fit between organisms and their environment. Each caterpillar and each butterfly is specially adapted to the plants that it feeds on. They share characteristics of unity, of life. They all have wings and antenna and abdomens, and they all have similar form and varied function. And they represent the diversity of life. So all lepidopterans are related, but there are many different kinds. From the Luna moth, the big green Luna moth that we sometimes see in the springtime, to the little fritillary butterflies that are the tiny little butterflies that fly around in the fields and meadows and walk through them. Here is an image of a caterpillar on a marigold flower. You can see here where the caterpillar has attached the little bits of the marigold petals to its back, and in this way it's camouflaged and is less likely to be found by predators. A new era of biology began in 1859 when Charles Darwin published The Origin of Species. The Origin of Species focused biologists' attention on the great diversity of organisms. Darwin began to be able to explain how all living things were related. Darwin noted that current species are descendants of ancestral species. Evolution can be defined by Darwin's phrase, descent with modification. Evolution can be viewed as both a pattern and a process. So it is part of the natural fabric. The Darwinian revolution challenged traditional views of a young Earth inhabited by unchanging species. Darwin's revolutionary ideas had deep historical roots, but they also challenged the way that people saw the world, which was through the lens of the church at the time. Here is a marine iguana that is found on the Galapagos Islands, where Darwin had most of his major revelations about the process of evolution. These are related to the big green iguanas that people keep as pets here that eat vegetables and plant material. The marine iguanas also eat plant material, but they eat seaweed that grows on the rocks on the crashing waves of the Galapagos Islands. And they're able to hold on to those rocks with their specially adapted claws, and they can swim in the ocean, which no other iguana does. But otherwise, they're very similar to arboreal iguanas or tree iguanas that occur on the mainland of South America. But yet they found their way to the Galapagos Islands, probably on rafts of logs and flotsam and jetsam, And then that once they arrived, they began to evolve to fill the open ecological niche there of the littoral, which means shoreline herbivore. So it feeds on the seaweed. The Greek philosopher Aristotle viewed species as fixed and arranged, and arranged them on the scala naturae. Aristotle believed that everything was existed as it has always existed and has never changed. This is similar in view to the Old Testament, which holds that species were individually designed by God and therefore perfect and unchanging. The Old Testament also promotes the idea that the earth is only 6,000 years old, which is in contradiction to modern geological theory and evolutionary theory. Carolus Linnaeus, or Carl Linnaeus, was the son of peasants who was very well educated, and he went on to interpret organismal adaptations as evidence that the Creator had designed each species for a particular purpose. Linnaeus was the founder of taxonomy, the branch of biology concerned with classifying organisms. He developed the binomial format for naming species, which is the genus species format, and our species is known as Homo sapiens. Homo means same, and sapiens means wise. So it's the same as us, we're wise. Wise ones, the same. There's also Homo neanderthalensis and other species that are now extinct. The genus and species for marijuana is Cannabis sativa or Cannabis indica. The genus and species for the great blue heron is Ardea herodias. So these Latin binomials are to help us understand what the different species are as distinct from one another, instead of using common names which may be confused. The study of fossils help us lay the groundwork of Darwin's ideas. Fossils are remains or traces of organisms from the past, usually found in sedimentary rock, which appears in layers or strata. Now, here is an example of sedimentary rock being laid down in a lake or on the coastal plain of an ocean. You can see here where the erosion is occurring in the mountains. It's being carried down by the stream, and it's winding up on the... Oh, I didn't mean to do that. And it's winding up on the seafloor. And years after years after the erosion occurs through different types of rock, different types of sediment are laid down in different layers. The older stratum, more towards the bottom of the sedimentary rocks, will have older fossils, and the younger stratum will have more recent fossils. So here up near the surface, that's more recently deposited, and down in the bottom, that's older deposition. And then these areas are revealed by rivers again. These rivers come through and they cut through, they erode the soil and the rock, and they take that sediment and they deposit it right back out into the oceans and lakes. Paleontology is the study of fossils, was largely developed by the French scientist Georges Cuvier. He had an immense amount of influence on the discipline. Cuvier speculated that each boundary between strata represents a catastrophe that destroyed many species. And in part, he is correct about this, although there are differences in sedimentary strata that do not represent catastrophes, but at the same time, there are, and we'll learn about some of those in the future. Geologists James Hutton and Charles Lyell perceived that changes in the Earth's surface can result from slow, continuous actions still operating today. Lyell further proposed that the mechanisms of change are constant over time. So the rate of erosion should be more or less constant over time. This strongly influenced Darwin's thinking. Now, Lyell was partially correct about this, because there are times when there's like massive mountain building where tectonic plates collapse on one another and cause earthquakes and volcanoes to erupt. And those can occur, in, relatively speaking, in geological time. They can occur in a short period of time. But Lyell proposed that these happen over a constant period of time, and his understanding basically gave us the idea that the Earth was greater than 6,000 years old. This view strongly influenced Darwin's thinking. Now there was Lamarck. Lamarck was a biologist who hypothesized that species evolved through the use and disuse of body parts and the inheritance of acquired characteristics. These mechanisms he proposed are unsupported by evidence. So what Lamarck's famous observation was that he believed that giraffes stretched their necks and to reach the higher leaves, and that the giraffes with that would stretch their own necks, they would wind up with longer necks, and they would pass that trait down onto their offspring. This is not what we understand now. Now we understand natural selection, wherein many offspring of the giraffe populations, some of them have long necks, some of them have short necks. The ones with the long necks are given to survive in under periods of drought and duress, and the survivors live to produce offspring. Now here's an example of a Lamarckian idea. You would think that this tiny little tree, this bonsai tree, here cultivated by a Japanese bonsai master, would be one that would yield offspring of the same size. But in fact, if you cultivate the seeds from these bonsai trees, they will give you regular size trees. Regular size, in this case, I believe that's a juniper. So those, they do not, based on the traits that they've acquired here, they do not reproduce with those. Those are not inherited traits. So traits that affect evolution have to be heritable. They have to be inherited from one generation to the next. Descent with modification by natural selection explains the adaptations of organisms and the unity and diversity of life. Some doubt about the permanence of species preceded Darwin's ideas. Okay, so people believe that species did go extinct over time. As a boy and into adulthood, Charles Darwin had a consuming interest in nature. He first studied medicine at the theology and then theology at the Cambridge University. When he went as a student of medicine, he found that he was shocked by the sight of blood, so he knew he would never be a successful surgeon. And he turned then to theology, where at the time, theology was a broad encompassing field, and you could study nature as a theologian at Cambridge University, one of the most prestigious universities in the world, and it was so then as well. After graduating, he took an unpaid position as a naturalist and companion to Robert Fitzroy for a 5-year around-the-world voyage on the HMS Beagle. During his travels on the Beagle, Darwin collected specimens of South American plants and animals. He observed that fossils resembled living species from the same region, and living species resembled other species from nearby regions. He experienced an earthquake in Chile that raised the earth 2 to 3 feet and observed the uplift of rocks. It was an amazing experience for Darwin, and he really started to understand geological processes as a result. The tectonic plates, one running underneath the other, pushing the other up and causing the earth to shudder as it moved over time. And this had a big influence on Darwin. He began reading the works of Lyell, and he began to understand a different way of looking at geological history. Darwin was influenced by Lyell's principles of geology, and thought that the earth was more than 6,000 years old. His interest in geographic distribution of species was kindled by a stop at the Galapagos Islands west of South America. He hypothesized that species from South America had colonized the Galapagos and speciated on the islands. So he realized that they were similar to the mainland species, but they had developed special adaptations for the Galapagos Islands. Here are a bunch of videos. I don't think I'm able to play these for you, so I'm not going to bother to do that. If you're interested, we can go over them in class, or I can try to make these PowerPoints available to you online. Darwin, in 1840, after his return from the voyage, was quite impacted by what he had observed. He had traveled literally all around the entire world, from Great Britain, around South America, through the Galapagos Islands. This is where he made his important observations, through New Zealand, Australia, up through the Indian Ocean, around the Cape of Good Hope, through Brazil, and back to Great Britain. When he returned, he began writing. He wrote volumes and volumes about his observations, but he never made them public. He kept them until 15 years later, 20 years later, when he was when he felt that the world was ready to for these observations to be published. In reassessing his observations, Darwin perceived that adaptation to the environment and the origin of new species as closely related processes. From studies made years after Darwin's voyage, biologists have concluded that this was what happened to the Galapagos finches. Here are the Galapagos finches. They're very famous. There's about 8 or 9 different species here. Here are some that are this very distinct. There's a finch that specializes on eating cactuses, a finch that specializes on eating seeds, and a finch that specializes on eating insects. If you look at these at the beaks of these finches, it's very interesting because the each species is separately adapted to its own ecological niche. A cactus eater looks kind of like the finches that we have around here. You may see purple finches or house finches. They're very common around our area. And then if you look at the seed eater finch, its bill is heavier. It's more adapted to cracking open seeds. This is like the bill of the cardinal that everyone knows. The cardinal's the state bird of Virginia. And it's more readily adapted to cracking open seeds. Then there's the insect eater type finch. Now these are all related. Look at the beaks; they're very distinct, but they are related. They have a common ancestor. And the insect eater finch has a beak that's much more like a robin. Everybody knows the robin from the robins spend all year round in the Virginia, Central Virginia area, but they're particularly plentiful in the springtime, and they have these long pointy beaks. That's because they're insect eaters. They specialize on eating worms and other insects. Here's the cactus eater, the seed eater, and the insect eater. In 1844, Darwin wrote an essay on natural selection as the mechanism of descent with modification, but he did not introduce his theory publicly. He was sure that he was going to be scoffed at, especially by the church, which was very popular, very powerful at the time. Natural selection is a process in which individuals with favorable inherited traits are more likely to survive and reproduce. In 1858, Darwin received a manuscript from Alfred Russel Wallace, who had developed a theory of natural selection similar to Darwin's. Darwin quickly finished The Origin of Species and published it next year. So Darwin was basically pushed by Wallace to make his observations published. Wallace had done his observations in the Malay Archipelago, which is like Indonesia area, and he had made observations on different birds and different animals and a particular flying frog, a frog that has large webbed toes that it can leap from tree to tree and glide from tree to tree. And Russell Wallace, he speculated on the origins of this, and he also developed the theory of natural selection very similar to Darwin's. He came and spoke to Darwin about this, and it gave Darwin the impetus to then publish his own work before he was scooped by Wallace. But Wallace and Darwin were friends, and they worked together on future works about evolution, and Wallace always gave Darwin credit for having developed the notion of evolution. Even though he developed it separately, they shared credit, and Darwin received the lion's share of that credit. Here's the little flying frog, and here's Wallace, Alfred Russel Wallace, as he's depicted when he returned from his travels. He experienced a calamitous event when he was on a boat, and there was a giant storm, and it wrecked his ship, and he survived that shipwreck, and he swore he would never travel again. But then his love of observation and science led him back to the Malay Archipelago, and he did travel again. He had conquered his fears. Darwin explained three broad observations about life: the unity of life, the diversity of life, and the match between organisms and their environment, their adaptations to the environment. Darwin never used the word evolution in the first edition of Origin of Species. The phrase "descent with modification" summarized Darwin's perceptions in the unity of life. The phrase refers to the view that all organisms are related through descent from an ancestor that lived in the remote past. In the Darwinian view, the history of life is like a tree with branches that represent life's diversity. Fossils of extinct species help to fill in the blanks, the morphological gaps between present-day groups. Here's an example of, this is Darwin's actual notes that he made on evolution, where he illustrated that some founding organisms were radiated out into other living organisms today. So there was a past simple organism that radiated out into more complex organisms. Or this could be the finches, where one species of finch was found its way to the Galapagos Islands from mainland South America, and then it radiated out into all these different types of finches over time and through the adaptation to the different ecological environments. Now, here's an interesting thing to look at. This is the lineage of the elephant, the modern African elephant. And it shows here, these are basically more primitive animals, are evolved earlier, 60 million years ago, and more advanced animals are evolved more recently, 2 million, 3 million, 5 million years ago. Okay, not that long ago. But it's interesting to note that through morphological characteristics and through genetics, we are able to build a phylogenetic tree that shows us the relationship of these seemingly disparate animals. The hyrax is an animal that looks like a groundhog. It's not a rodent at all. It's more closely related to manatees and to elephants of any other living organisms. But it is... It's small and furry. You wouldn't think of an elephant at all when you looked at it. Then the Sirenia, the manatees and dugongs, and they They are quite distinct in appearance, and you really wouldn't think that they would be related to the elephants. But they are a long time ago, 60 million years ago, they shared a common ancestry. Every node on these branches represents a common ancestor. Common ancestor here, common ancestor here. And these animals that their lineage does not extend up to the present day, they're all extinct. Some are more recently extinct than others. The mammoth is believed to, the mastodon, I'm sorry, this is a mastodon, and the woolly mammoth existed in North America maybe as recently as 20 or 30,000 years ago. Some people think even earlier, even more recently than that. 10,000, 6,000 years ago. Some people believe that the woolly mammoth existed contemporaneously with some Native American cultures. So that's pretty recent. Now, there's argument about that, but some people say it's true and some people say it's not true. Now, there is then following that, there's the Asian elephant and then the African elephant. There's two different species of African elephants, and that represents the lineage today. So here we see where these fossil species, extinct species, fill in the steps on the evolutionary ladder on the way to the African elephant. Artificial selection, natural selection, and adaptation. Darwin noted that humans have modified other species by selecting and breeding individuals with desired traits, a process called artificial selection. Artificial selection is it's very easy to observe. Any domesticated animal has been artificially selected. Dogs, cats, pigeons, chickens, sheep, goats, cattle. Dogs in particular are very interesting and easy to observe. The Chihuahua, one of the smallest dogs in the world, is the same species as the Great Dane, one of the largest dogs in the world. So the Great Dane and the Chihuahua, you could crossbreed them if you were able to do that. You'd probably want to crossbreed a male Chihuahua with a female Great Dane. And in theory, you could get a viable offspring that would be able to reproduce. So any of these, like Labradoodles or these crossbreeds that we have nowadays are all made possible because of artificial selection. Darwin argued that a similar process also occurs in nature, a process which he termed natural selection, in which nature acted as the selecting device rather than human beings. Now, here's a wild mustard here in the center of this image here. The wild mustard is the progenitor of all of these common vegetables: kale, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, broccoli, kohlrabi. There's even a couple of others that are not included here. But they were all artificially selected to be bred for different characteristics, and they're all the same species, believe it or not. Kale and broccoli are the same species. They're just different cultivars, different varieties that have been cultivated by human beings. Darwin drew two inferences from two observations. Observation one, members of a population often vary in their inherited traits. So members of a given population can have many different phenotypic or genotypic traits, and those traits can make those individuals more or less adapted to their environment. If they're more adapted, they'll be more successful and provide more offspring. If they're less adapted, then the reverse is true. They'll have less offspring and be less adapted to that environment. Here is the an image of ladybug beetles. You can see there's lots of phenotypic variation. A phenotype is the physical type of the appearance of an organism, and a genotype is the genetic type or the genetic underlying characteristics of the organism, the gene. Observation number two, all species produce more offspring than the environment can support, and many of these offspring fail to survive and reproduce. Okay, so what I was talking about before, so the all these species produce more offspring than the environment can support, and many of these offsprings fail to survive and reproduce. So you get, like, insects are a great example. They produce tons of offspring. Some of them are better adapted to the environment than others, and some of them fail. So here's a puffball fungus. Yeah, everybody's familiar with these. They come out a couple days after it rains, and they're all nice and dry, and you step on them, and they puff out these spore clouds. Well, each one of those spores could become a new fungal organism. A fungus is it's the ball of hyphae that occur underneath the fungus here. So this is just the fruiting body here, the puffball, and then underneath it, this is where there's like kind of the roots of the fungus. That's where the fungus really exists. And then these spores are expelled after they're rained on or kicked by some student, and then they spread out their spores over the landscape. And some of those spores survive, and some of those spores die. The ones that survive, of course, live to impart their characteristics onto the next generation. Inference number two, individuals whose inherited traits give them a higher probability of surviving and reproducing in a given environment tend to leave more offspring than their other individuals. Inference number two, this unequal ability of individuals to survive and reproduce will lead to the accumulation of favorable traits in the population over generations. Darwin was influenced by Thomas Malthus, who was an economist who noted that potential for human population to increase faster than food supplies and other resources. If some heritable traits are advantageous, these will accumulate in a population over time, and this will increase the frequency of individuals with these traits. This process explains the match between the organisms and their environment. Individuals with certain heritable traits, traits that are able to be inherited by one generation to the next, heritable traits survive and reproduce at a higher rate than other individuals. Over time, natural selection increases the match between organisms and their environment. If an environment changes over time, natural selection may result in adaptation to these new conditions and may give rise to new species. Here are a flower mantid in Malaysia and a leaf mantid in Borneo. Now, mantids are really interesting because they have quite an interesting evolutionary natural history. You can barely see the flower mantid here. It's escaping predation by blending in with these masses of flowers, purple flowers, and it's evolved to blend into that environment almost perfectly. You can just barely see it, even as a human being with a discerning eye. And birds are very good at picking out patterns. Birds, their primary predator, but they're even able to fool birds. Here's a leaf mantid, which you can barely see on the ground in Borneo amongst the dried up leaves. So it's easy to imagine that birds will be eating mantids that do not look like leaves, and so they leave the mantids that do look like leaves remaining. So all the other organisms in the population are picked off by predation or other natural selection factors in environment, weather, climate, their ability to feed on varying resources, and those different characteristics help those or cause those organisms to adapt. They either adapt and survive or do not adapt and fail and die. Individuals do not evolve. Populations evolve over time. Although individuals can have mutations, and if those mutations are beneficial, they will be contributed to the population, and if they are beneficial over time, then those populations will begin to change and develop those adaptations in the population. So populations evolve over time. Natural selection can increase or decrease heritable traits that vary in a population. Adaptations vary with different environments. The leaf mantid is adapted to its environment in Borneo, and the flower mantid is adapted to its environment in Malaysia. New discoveries continue to fill the gaps identified by Darwin and the Origin of Species. There are four types of data that basically support and document the pattern of evolution. There are direct observations, homology, the fossil record, and biogeography. Two examples provide evidence for natural selection. Natural selection in response to introduced plant species and the evolution of drug-resistant bacteria. So this is an observation that you can make on a very short time scale because bacteria reproduce at such a rapid rate that their adaptations to the environment can be visualized and observed very readily. Soapberry bugs use their beak to feed on seeds within fruits. So here are a true bug that feeds on seeds. It has to penetrate through the fruit to get through the seed. And some fruits in southern Florida, the fruits are larger, and so those soapberry bugs have longer beaks. In central Florida, they feed on the golden rain tree, which is a smaller fruit, and those bugs have shorter beaks. The correlation between fruit size and beak size has also been observed in Louisiana, Oklahoma, and Australia. So because insects reproduce on such a high frequency, rapid rate as well, these adaptations can be observed very readily. In all cases, beak size has evolved in populations that feed on introduced plants with fruits that are smaller or larger than native fruits. These cases are examples of evolution by natural selection. In Florida, the evolution in beak size occurred in less than 35 years, so it was readily available when these bugs were brought in to into the area. When the plants that were brought into the area and the bugs were able to evolve very rapidly. Okay, here's a little study. The soapberry bug with a beak inserted into a balloon vine. Here's the larger fruit of the soapberry of the balloon vine, the smaller fruit of the golden rain tree, and you can see the beak length is shorter in the these are the same bugs, same species, same genus, same species. They're the same bug, and they have evolved these different phenotypic characteristics based on the environmental characteristics of the food that they are surviving on. Okay, now everybody knows about staphylococcus infections. Staph infections, you get them in your throat. You can even get them in some injuries. Staphylococcus aureus is that bacteria. It is commonly found on people's skin or in their nasal passages, and we normally have the ability to repel them as an infectious agent. So they're not normally a problem for us. They're very common. Now, recently, there has been a resurgence or an upsurge in what's known as methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, or MRSA. MRSA strains are dangerous pathogens. Staphylococcus aureus became resistant to penicillin in 1945, 2 years after penicillin was first widely used. And S. aureus became resistant to methicillin in 1961, just a couple years after methicillin was first reduced. So Staphylococcus became resistant to penicillin. People started using methicillin. Staphylococcus became resistant to methicillin. Now, MRSA is a very dangerous organism. I have a couple of friends that have experienced MRSA infections, and it can be life-threatening. I had one friend who got MRSA infection in his spine, and it almost killed him. He was just out in the hospital for 6 months. So it's a terrible infection, and it can be very detrimental to your health. Methicillin works by inhibiting a protein used by bacteria in their cell walls. MRSA bacteria use a different protein in their cell walls and therefore are resistant to methicillin. When exposed to methicillin, MRSA strains are more likely to survive and reproduce than non-resistant Staphylococcus aureus strains. MRSA strains are now resistant to many antibiotics. It's a real problem. You have to really search for the antibiotic cocktail that will knock out the MRSA strain. So here is the chromosome. You remember from your study in genetics that bacteria have plasmid chromosomes, circular chromosomes, and these different adaptations, methicillin resistant, ability to colonize hosts, increased severity, increased gene exchange within species, and toxin promotion. These are all traits of methicillin. And what's important here is you look at this graph here, and you can see since 1993, so in 20 years, or in 10 years from this point, you can see that methicillin-resistant populations have become a greater hazard to people in the United States with infections of MRSA. Okay, here's the diagram of the gene, of the MRSA gene. I don't expect you to know all this, but you just become familiarized. And it's interesting to know that we have the capacity to map out the chromosomes of the Staphylococcus in this way. Natural selection does not create new traits, but it edits or selects for traits that are already present in the population. So those soapberry bugs, some of them already have long beaks in the short beak population, but the short beak animals, the short beak bugs, are able to outcompete them for that resource. So they don't succeed. But where they do succeed is in the larger fruit population, the population with feeds on the larger fruits, and then those bugs are successful there. So natural selection is not creating those traits. Those traits exist within the population, or they could be mutations, but it edits or selects for traits that are already present in the population. The local environment determines which traits will be selected for and which selected against in any specific population. Homology. Evolution is a process of modification. Related species can have characteristics with underlying similarity that function differently. Homology is similarity resulting from common ancestry. Homology is similarity resulting from common ancestry. Homologous structures are anatomical resemblances that represent variations on a structural theme present in common ancestor. Here we see the arm of the human being, the arm of a cat, the fin of a whale, and the hand of a bat, or the wing of a bat. And all of these have the same bones. Phalanges are the fingers, even in the whale, which has the flipper, has phalanges, and the bat wing. And then the metacarpals are the hands of the bones of the hand, here in the cat, here in the whale, here in the bat. The radius and the ulna They are also present in the cat and the whale, even in the whale and in the bat. The humerus, the long bone of the arm, in the also found in the cat and even in the whale. So the and also in the bat. Now it's pretty easy to see the similarity between the wing of the bat and the hand of the human. It just looks just like a hand, and it's that those are homologous structures. But what's less clear is the whale. Now all of these are males, mammals, and all of them are tetrapods. All tetrapods have these similar structures, from salamanders to humans. They all have similar structures, but they're more apparent in the mammals. So we look at the mammals, we can observe, and we can make some conjecture about the common ancestry of all these species. Comparative embryology reveals anatomical homologies that are not available, not visible in adult organisms. Vestigial structures are remnants of features that serve important functions in the organism's ancestors. So, vestigial structures are like the appendix in a human being on the large intestine, on the colon. It occurs at the beginning end of the colon. Now, some of you may have had your appendix removed. I had my appendix removed when I was on a trip in Hawaii on studying honey creeper finches on the Mauna Kea Mountain on the Big Island of Hawaii. And my appendix burst, and I could feel it. And it's a vestigial structure, so they just went in, the surgeon went in and removed the appendix. It's not a problem. It's not really used in human beings anymore. But in the great apes, in gorillas and chimpanzees, the appendix is more developed, and it houses particular bacteria that help those apes to digest plant material. We don't eat as much plant material as the great apes do, so our appendix is vestigial. And believe it or not, some human beings are even born with tails. It's a very rare occurrence, but it does happen. Human beings can be born with vestigial tails. Normally, a surgeon will just cut that tail off to spare the child from being ridiculed during his life. But it does occur, and there are other examples of vestigial structures that are useless in the modern organism, but at one time useful in an ancestral organism. Okay, here is two embryos, a chicken embryo and a human embryo. They have similarities. They both have pharyngeal arches, which are believed to be related to gills. You can even go back as far as fish and find similarities in embryos there. And the post-anal tail. These are vestigial structures. Well, a chicken does have a tail, but human beings don't have a tail. But they do, as I said, they are sometimes born with a post-anal tail. Human beings can be born with a post-anal tail. This observation is known as phylogeny recapitulates itogeny, and it's the idea that the ancestral traits are present in the embryonic phase. It's not really believed the way that it was originally, but there are some observable traits that can be found in the embryo that are not found in the adult organism. Examples of homologies at the molecular level are genes shared among common organisms inherited from common ancestor. Homologous genes can be found in organisms as dissimilar as human beings and bacteria. Genes that code for certain proteins in bacteria are also the same genes that code for those same proteins in human beings. Convergent evolution is the evolution of a similar or analogous features in distantly related groups. Analogous traits arise when groups independently adapt to similar environments in similar ways. Convergent evolution does not provide information about ancestry. Here is the sugar glider and the flying squirrel. They're morphologically very similar. Ecologically, they're a little different. Sugar gliders tend to eat more insects. Flying squirrels eat more acorns and nuts and what have you like that. I actually did my master's thesis work on the flying squirrel. There's an endangered species that lives in the mountains of Virginia and North Carolina that can be feeds on a certain kind of fungus that lives under tree roots in these high elevation regions. And anyway, that's an aside. The sugar glider is a marsupial, and it's evolved separately from the placental mammals. So flying squirrels are placental mammals, sugar gliders are marsupial mammals. They separated from each other a long time ago, about 50-60 million years ago, and flying squirrels went on their evolutionary path, the sugar gliders went on their evolutionary path, but they because they have similar escape strategies, leaping from one tree to another, then they are able to, they do have similar morphological traits. The fossil record provides evidence of extinction of species, origin of new groups, and changes within groups over time. Okay, here is the astragalus. It's the ankle bone of most mammals and some reptiles and amphibians as well. But basically what you want to observe here is that Pachycetus, which is a fossil a fossil organism, is kind of like a segue between carnivores, dogs, and artiodactyls, the even-toe ungulates, like pigs and deer. So it's like a midway, like a missing link organism between carnivores and herbivores, if you want to look at it that way. Fossils can document important transitions. For example, the transition from land to sea in the ancestors of cetaceans. Okay, so here is Pachycetus. It's a mammal, had a common ancestor with the hippopotamus. So believe it or not, the hippopotamus is the the closest living relative to whales. Living cetaceans like toothed whales, like the dolphins or porpoises and killer whales, and baleen whales like the blue whale or the humpback whale. Their most closest living relative is the hippopotamus. Okay, extinct relatives include the Pachycetus, Rhodocetus, Dorodon. These are all extinct animals, okay, that are in that phylogenetic lineage on the way to living cetaceans, on the way to whales. Here's the little hand bone of the whale. Okay, so here's the leg bones of the Pachycetus, and these are the homologous traits in here, the phalanges, okay, the pelvis, okay, that's retained. And okay, we're looking at the rear end of the whale here. So here's the rear leg of Pachycetus, the rear leg of Rhodocetus, the rear leg. It's a very vestigial structure in Dorodon, and then it's practically absent in the living cetaceans in the whales. Dicodexis is an early even-toed ungulate, okay, on the way to the pigs and deer. And biogeography, the geographic distribution of species provides evidence of evolution. Earth's continents were formerly united in a single large continent called Pangaea, but have since separated by continental drift. An understanding of continent movement and modern distribution of species allows us to predict when and where different groups evolved. Endemic species are species that are not found on anywhere else in the world. Islands have many endemic species that are often closely related to species on the nearest mainland or island. Darwin explained that species on islands gave rise to new species as they adapted new environments. What is theoretical about Darwin's view of life? Okay, in science, a theory is something that is a particular construct of knowledge. It doesn't have the same in typical vernacular English. We talk about a theory. Oh, you have a theory about this. I have a theory about that. In that term, it just means an idea or a notion. But a theory in the scientific term means a very specific construct. You have to have observable phenomenon. You make a hypothesis to test that observable phenomenon. And if that hypothesis holds up over time and scrutiny, then you develop a theory. So a theory is more like an ideological construct. It's a term that refers to an idea that's been tested. So in science, a theory accounts for many observations and explains and integrates a great variety of phenomena. The predictions of a scientific theory may stand up to a continual testing by experimentation and observation. Darwin's theory of evolution by natural selection integrates diverse areas of biological study and stimulates many new research questions. Ongoing research adds to our understanding of evolution. Okay, so for example, in Trinidad, they have these pools in a waterfall, and they had guppies that were being chased by these predatory pike cichlids in one waterfall, and they moved them into pools with the killifish, which are also predatory on guppies, but they had no guppies in that. And over time, over several generations, the characteristics of the guppies changed to be able to withstand the predation of the killifish, and they changed from the guppies that were evolved to withstand the predation of the pike cichlids. This is something that's in your textbook. You can review it. I'm not going to ask you to know it, but it's good information to understand. Okay, so they were looking at the different amounts of colored spots on these guppies. The colored spots helped them to hide from the cichlids, and in the different populations, those qualities changed over time. Okay, so observations. Individuals in a population vary in their inheritable characteristics. Also, observations produce more offspring than the environment can support. Therefore, individuals that are well suited to the environment tend to leave more offspring than other individuals. And over time, favorable traits accumulate within the population. Okay, so mosquitoes that are resistant to DDT over time, small number of mosquitoes are resistant to DDT over 8 months, 12 months, more larger and larger populations of the mosquitoes are resistant to DDT. So they're being killed, just like the MRSA, you know, some of those infection are being killed off by penicillin or methicillin, or in this case of mosquitoes, by DDT. And then over time, a few organisms have inherent in their qualities the ability to adapt to that DDT poisoning, and then they survive, and then their offspring survive, and then their offspring survive, and that's how you have evolution.